as we prepare to hear from Brother Farrakhan, inshallah, in just a few minutes, I want you to open your eyes, open your ears, and get ready to hear God talk to you. You're not listening to me. You want to talk to God? You want to hear God. You pray to God to answer your prayers, but how is God going to answer your prayers? Is he going to start talking to you in a dream? Is he going to start whispering something in your ear? And if he answers your prayer through another human being, through another man, another mortal like yourself, will you reject him if you hear God in him? Then you would have to say, or take your time and re-examine and listen for the man of God. Here he is, the Honorable Louis Farrakhan. Let's receive him with a warm round of applause. The Honorable Louis Farrakhan. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar.
Thank you. In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, who came in the person of Master Farad Muhammad, to whom praise is due forever. We thank Allah for blessing us with our beloved leader, teacher, and guide, the messenger of Allah, the Messiah, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. I greet all of you, my dear brothers and sisters, with the greeting words of peace. Assalamu alaikum. Tonight, I would like to continue with the thought raised by myself through Minister Ismail Muhammad on Monday night at FOI. The sisters didn't hear it. I want to read to you from the 9th surah or chapter of the Holy Quran. O Prophet, strive hard against the disbelievers and the hypocrites, and be firm against them, and their abode is hell, and evil is the destination. They swear by Allah that they said nothing, and certainly they did speak the word of disbelief and disbelieved after their Islam. And they purposed that which they could not attain. And they sought revenge only because Allah, as well as His Messenger, had enriched them out of His grace. So if they repent, it will be good for them. And if they turn away, Allah will chastise them with a painful chastisement in this world and the hereafter. And they shall have in the earth neither a friend nor a helper. And of them are those who made a covenant with Allah. If He give us out of His grace, we will certainly give alms and be of the righteous. But when He gave them out of His grace, they became niggardly of it, and they turned away, and they are averse. So He requited them with hypocrisy in their hearts till the day when they meet Him, because they broke their promise with Allah, and because they lied. Now these verses of the Quran are directed toward a particular class of people. And that class of person or people, persons or people is considered in the lowest depth of the fire, because there is nothing lower in the sight of God than a hypocrite. They're even lower than a devil, because a devil is a devil. But a hypocrite feigns to be of the righteous, while in his heart he's an enemy of the righteous. The sad thing about this is that the person comes in to Islam and submits, and then they speak the word of disbelief after they have said they submit. Then they purpose that which they could not attain. And what is that? What is it that the hypocrites purpose that they cannot attain? That is the destruction of Islam and the murder of the messenger. And they sought revenge. They were angry with God because he enriched them out of his grace with wisdom and a messenger from himself. But even though they're in that condition, Allah holds out mercy. And he says, so if they repent, it will be good for them. But if they turn away, Allah will chastise them with a painful chastisement in this world and the hereafter. And there are those who are hypocrites who made a covenant with Allah. It's like a bargain. And they said, if you, Allah, will give us out of your grace, we will certainly give alms or pay the poor rate, and we will be of the righteous. But when Allah gave them out of his grace, they became niggardly of that grace, meaning they would not give in charity. They would not support the cause, even though they told Allah that if he blessed them, they would certainly be of the righteous, and they would certainly give out of what he had given them. But when he blessed them, they held their money in their pockets. They wouldn't give. They wouldn't help. They would do nothing. So Allah requited them with hypocrisy in their hearts. They weren't hypocrites, but as a result of their niggardliness, Allah requited them with hypocrisy. He paid them back by making them what they became. Hypocrites, because they broke their promise with Allah and because they lied. What was the lie that they told? They told Allah that if he blessed them, they would be of the righteous and they would certainly help the messenger. And when he blessed them, they broke their promise. They wouldn't give. And so God punished them by turning them into hypocrisy because they broke their promise with him. When you got those kind of persons, hypocrites, they could be our wives, our husbands. It could be our sons, our daughters. It could be our friends and loved ones. Your test and my test is not being firm against somebody else who's a hypocrite. But the prophet is told, strive hard against the disbelievers. strive hard against the hypocrites and be firm against them. Their abode is hell, and evil is their destination. You can't have a tender spot in your heart for hypocrites. You can't have a tender spot in your heart for disbelievers. A person who has never heard the truth is not a disbeliever. There are millions of our people who have never heard the truth. Don't call them disbelievers, because they've never had a chance to hear that they might be classified as a disbeliever. But a disbeliever is one who hears the truth and rejects it and refuses to believe in it. Do you follow what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
Then when a person is a rejecter of the truth, after they hear it, the person who loves the truth has to be firm with them. Why? Because a disbeliever is not going to be satisfied until he pulls a believer back into disbelief. It could be your mother, it could be your father, it could be your husband, a wife, friend. When they disbelieve, they don't respect what you believe, do they? So when they disbelieve, they say things against your belief to weaken you in that which you have accepted that has given you life. So you can't be tender toward them. You have to be firm. It didn't say bust them in the mouth. It didn't say shoot them. It just said be firm against them. And, you know, but that is even difficult when you love people. It's hard for a mother to be firm against her disbelieving son or daughter, isn't it? It's hard for a child to be firm against a disbelieving parent. But that's what the Quran demands. Didn't say be disrespectful, said be firm. And when you're firm against something, that means you're standing resolutely, strongly, steadfastly against something that God Himself disapproves. He don't like disbelievers. And He certainly does not like hypocrites. Now why, Farrakhan, are you taking up a subject like this? In the book of Revelations, it talks about a dragon that stood before the woman who was about to deliver her child. She was carrying a man-child. And that child was destined to rule the nations, plural, with a rod of iron. So what the dragon saw was a baby coming into the world that was going to supplant or replace him as a ruler. He didn't want the new ruler to supplant him, so he stood before the woman to devour her child as soon as it was born. Now, in this, sisters, there's a warning to you. We live in a time now, or at a time, when the enemy is upset over so many black babies coming on the planet. Who produces them? Who produces them? You do. So the book is telling you that at a certain point, the enemy is going to attack the black woman. And this is happening right now as we speak. The Ku Klux Klan has said from Atlanta, Georgia, I don't know whether you saw the television show, I didn't get a chance to see it, but I heard about it, that this man, Wayne Williams, that was accused of killing all those little boys and a few girls in Atlanta, that he really was innocent of that, but they suppressed information that would have led directly to the Ku Klux Klan because they did not want black people to know that white people were killing young black boys while they were building Atlanta to be this great city with business opportunity. A race riot would have destroyed that image and set the city back. So they suppressed that evidence, according to this television show. Wayne Williams became the scapegoat while they knew it was members of the Ku Klux Klan. And one of these demons, members of the Ku Klux Klan, said that they were killing young boys, but they were going to start killing the black woman who produces these nigger children. Which, as you may recall, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, before he departed from us, he stopped our sisters from coming out to night meetings. Only the brothers came out at night. Do you remember that? There was no Wednesday night, no Friday night that the sisters came out. Just a skeleton crew of officials to handle the women who might come to the mosque. But the sisters were not here. He never let the sisters then have jobs at night. And he said that the sisters should not go out on the street at night unless you are accompanied by your father, your husband, or your brother. But you should not be alone in the streets at night. Now, this was in the 70s. Now we're in the 90s, and they are actually killing our women. We had a flyer where they were talking about black women who were domestics working in white communities, how they would be at the bus stops, and they would attack them at the bus stops and kill them by injecting air into their veins with hypodermic needles. They said this publicly, and the dragon stood before the woman. On the purely physical level, sisters, you do not know how important you are to the future of the nation, and don't you realize that the enemy is set to destroy the black woman? Because if he destroys you, we have no future. Now, how does the dragon destroy the woman? I'm going to deal with it on the spiritual level also, but I want to deal physically with the sisters. Sisters, I was driving today, early this morning, and as I drove down 55th Street, I saw a sister standing by the bus stop. She didn't see me. I don't know the sister. She had on a dress of decent length. She had on a headpiece. She was covered. And she was sitting there. And as I drove by and I saw her, I said a prayer. I wanted to just stop and let her know how proud I was that she was there dressed in a manner that would protect her. When you dress in the way the messenger taught us to dress, There's protection for you, sisters. This Quran is not a book of lies. This is a book of truth. And it tells the Muslim woman, lower the hem of your garment that you may be known. You don't want people not to know that you are the righteous. Because when you are known as the righteous, people think before they mess with you because they know you got protection. And they respect you when you respect yourself. I was proud of that sister. And I was going too fast to stop. But my mind told me just to stop and go over and thank her for striving to be right. And I know she would have been shocked to see Farrakhan and for me to stop her and congratulate her. Because to me, I appreciated her. This sister sitting right down in front, Sister Louise, no matter where I see you, sister, you are always dressed as a Muslim. And I want you to know from me publicly that I love you and I'm deeply respectful of you and honored, you know, that to know that I have a sister that will strive to be what the messenger asked. You know, you can testify to the rest of the sisters that as long as you dress like that, men don't whistle at you, they don't bother with you, they show you honor and respect. And I say this, sisters, and I will not force you to dress any way that you don't wish to dress. But you need protection in today's world. These people are so crazy, if they'll rape an 80-year-old woman, I mean, that is madness. But they do it. If they will molest a 6-month-old baby, then mothers, don't put your little girls in these little party clothes showing their little form and their little backside and you think it's cute. There's some sick people in this world. Even in your own house, tell the girls when they reach puberty, you cannot walk around in your own house uncovered, careless the way you sit, careless the way you dress. You must cover, and a good mother will make her daughter cover or smack the hell out of her. If I was a mother, I'd whoop the hell out of you. You wouldn't have to walk around my house naked, but one time, when I get finished with your behind, you have some clothes on. And every time I see you, I'd blaze you until you got that message. You know why? There are too many brothers sleeping with their sisters. There are too many fathers trying to mess with their daughters. There's too many uncles trying to mess with their nieces. And you wives, you gotta be alert. You sleep too damn much. And you let your girls run around in a house and you're asleep while there's strange men in the house. You better wake up and smell the coffee before we charge you and beat the hell out of you for your neglect of your own children. You say that's awful. You say that's terrible for a man of God to speak like that. Let me tell you something. You ain't met a man of God yet. A man of God will not only beat you, he'll kill you. Go read your Bible. Men of God don't play with you. no, no. You know, our women are sacred and they're precious. That's, I'm just saying this in this manner because you are so valuable. You are so precious in the sight of God. And for you not to put value on yourself and your daughters is sick. You just have to be a better and a stronger woman. You don't need no man if he gonna molest your child. You are the protector of your daughter. Even if you gotta kill a nigga, you are supposed to protect your daughters. They may put you in jail, but you'll come out quick. Yeah, I killed him. I'm not sending you home to kill your husband. But man, if you're doing that, you're worthy of death. And there will come a time when that kind of penalty will be carried out. None of us is that holy and that righteous yet, but many of us are striving to get there. Brothers, we have to look to our women with honor and respect. These men, we are the protectors of our women. You can't protect nothing that you don't control. So as a man, a woman has to give us a certain measure of control. You can't take it, she has to give it. We have to be worthy of that measure that she gives us. A woman is not going to give control to a fool. Nor should a woman give control to a fool. I'm not teaching rebellion, just some common sense. Now, sisters, the dragon, let's look at that word dragon. I know Minister Ishmael explained it in FOI, but we want to say it again because we can drive it deeper just by repeating it. There's no such thing as a dragon. There's no animal called dragon, is there? You haven't gone to the zoo to see the dragon, have you? So there's no dragon then, is it? See, if the Bible is talking about a dragon and there is no dragon in the zoo, and you don't know anybody that has seen a dragon, then it is a mythical animal, is that right? It appears in mythology. Okay, but look at the word dragon, dragon. When they say so-and-so is a drag, or the sissy goes out in drag. You understand what that means, right? He about to drag somebody down. Faking like he's a woman. You think you got a woman and you take her to where you would take a woman and find out you got a man. Ain't that a drag? You get what you pay for these days, brother. You pay for a man, you got what you paid for. You're in trouble. A dragon. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad said, when the truth comes to you, you, me, us, you mount up on truth. You start getting a feeling of elevation because truth raises you. It elevates you. It dignifies you. Here comes a dragon. Not a real animal, but a dragon is one that they say breathe fire, right? The Honorable Elijah Muhammad said that dragon means he drags you down off of the mount of truth that you have mounted up on. He drags you down and drags you out of the light into darkness again. Now, the dragon could be your brother sitting next to you, or your sister sitting next to you. How can my sister be a dragon? She don't look like that mythological creature to me. It ain't the looks, it's the action. You're a believer. You have come to faith. And somebody's sitting next to you breathing fire. Not that they got bad breath, and they may have. But even if they got sweet smelling breath, and they're speaking the word of disbelief after they believed, sitting next to you talking about, "I don't believe this. I don't like, I think so and so and so and so and so and so. Man, I just hate this now. You know what I mean? I come in here and I was, you know." And you sitting there listening to this. All of a sudden, like fire on a piece of wood, you see it begin to shrivel up, you know, change form. So you sitting next to a dragon who's breathing fire on your faith, speaking the word of disbelief after they believe, then all of a sudden you start shriveling up. You don't look the same anymore. You don't act the same. And people say, "Well, what's the matter with you? Your record shows." They don't attend anymore. They used to attend all the time, once a month. They used to give. Oh, they ain't giving no more. Used to sell the new. What happened to you? I don't know. I got to work. I got to make some money. The time I look around, you people is asking for money. I have to make some money, man. The real truth is somebody breathed on them and dragged them down off of the mount of truth and then dragged them out of dark, out of light into darkness. They come around the mosque, but you see their face is not lit anymore. Skin is ashy because the thought in the mind has changed. The dragon is that word. And the dragon stood before the woman to devour her child as soon as it was born. We dealt with the physical, now let's deal with the spiritual. In the spiritual sense, the woman here is referring to a messenger of God. He's like a woman in that the messenger is pregnant with a word that would deliver 30 million or 40 million people from the clutches of the beast or the Caucasian or the white world. So the woman, the messenger, is pregnant. And the dragon is standing in front of the woman, meaning he's opposing the messenger. He know he can't bring the messenger to disbelief, so he's working to devour the child as soon as it is born. When you come to the mosque, you hear a word, the conception of life is in your mind. You say, "Man, I like that." I go up and shake the minister's hand. You come up, you shake my hand. You fill out a form. You say, "Man, I really like this. Whoa, this is what I've been looking for all my life." You come to Mosque Maryam. That's why I called it Mary. Because she's pregnant with you. And you are going to be saviors of your people. So as Mary gave birth to Jesus, this mosque is going to give birth to male and female saviors who are going to go out of here born into the world to rise up and deliver your people. You understand? All praise is due to Allah. So the enemy stands before the mosque, Maryam, or before the minister, Farrakhan. Make it real plain. He's opposing me at every turn. But if he can't bring me to disbelief, the way he destroys me is to destroy you. So as soon as you come to birth as a Muslim, the idea is to kill you. Not necessarily physically, but to turn you back into disbelief and make you hate the day that you ever met Louis Farrakhan, so that you would purpose something that you could never attain. If all of you turn hypocrite together, you couldn't stop Islam. You couldn't stop the success of the message of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. You just can't do that. And you can't kill the apostle of God unless it pleases God that you do so. And I don't believe that it does. But that does not stop. That does not stop the hypocrite from having the thought in his mind or her mind to kill the apostle. What do you want to kill me for? Because Allah enriched you out of his grace. What is his grace? Wisdom. You came to me a damn fool, and I taught you knowledge and lifted you up from where you were. Why in the hell would you want an end to your brother? That's sick. That's madness. But some are thinking like that. And really what they're doing, it would be wise if they would repent of those thoughts, because it would be good for you if you do. But if you don't, the Quran says, Allah will chastise them with a painful chastisement in this world and the hereafter. And they shall have in the earth neither a friend nor a helper. That's a bad state to be in, brother, when you think you got friends and none of them are your friends. Because a hypocrite can't have a friend, because a hypocrite is a friend to nobody. Because he's a liar. She's a liar. When you are enemy of God, how in the hell can you be the friend of anybody? When God is the greatest benefactor of all of us, what right do we have to turn on God? And the dragon stood before the woman to devour her child as soon as it was born. What kind of child was it? It was a man child that was destined to rule the nations, all of them, with a rod of iron. In our lessons, the devil worked to destroy you when you are a baby. He's not going to let you grow into strength and power. Once he knows you're his enemy and you're a baby, he will kill the baby. That's why your babies are not doing well. Babies dying of AIDS. Babies sick. Babies being killed. But it's talking about you, brother, the black man. You have a great destiny. You don't think much of yourself, brothers, but you are some powerful men, all of you, is not one of you that is not potentially powerful. The enemy knows this. So he stands before the apostle to devour the man child, because he don't expect the woman to supplant him, but you will supplant the white man as a ruler. And that he never intends to see. So his aim is to destroy the black man and particularly the black child. And that's why FOI class is so important. And that's why you must understand, brothers, that we are at war, even though you don't see a bullet being fired. We are at war, but the war is fought on this level now. They're after the men. Before you can grow from a child into a man, they don't want to see you become a man. Kill you now. They want no competition. And so, brothers and sisters, we have to look at the enemy within. The enemy that's on the outside, that you can handle. But the enemy that you got to really watch for is the dragon. Sitting next to you, posing as a Muslim. They've already spoken the word of disbelief and disbelieve after their Islam, but they won't leave the mosque. They sit in the mosque and they come after every new brother and every new sister to poison them. Their aim is to destroy Islam. They can't do it. The enemy sent in a particular mosque a man in. He was a young man. And he worked his way up into the secretarial department. And he was told by those who sent him to steal the money of the poor believers who are giving their money in charity to the cause of Islam. He is an agent of the federal government working his way into the secretarial department to steal the funds of poor people so that we can't make progress for poor people. Isn't that something? This is going on right now. So everybody in the mosque is not a Muslim, though they all say assalamu alaikum. You got to understand that. Nothing wrong with that. That's just as it's written that it would be. You got people in here that are sincere, brothers and sisters, and you got people that are faking it. And if you don't know who the sincere ones are, who the fakers are, then you have to grow and be wise and watch and listen to people. And look, when I speak to you, you go out on a high, man. That's what truth does. If somebody is talking to you on the spirit of the minister, they don't kill your spirit, they lift your spirit. But when you're sitting next to somebody and they're talking to you and you go home and your head is all confused and messed up and you don't know right then whether you want to continue to be a Muslim or whether you want to give it up, that person is different from the minister who spoke to you and raised you up. That's a person trying to kill you. And yet they say assalamu alaikum and give you a big smile, maybe even loan you some money when you think you need it. And you won't say nothing on them. You won't report them to the minister Ishmael or the officials. You won't say nothing. Oh, he's my friend. But I'm so messed up, man. Damn. I couldn't sleep all night long. God. He didn't have to tell me that. Well, then he see you the next day. How you doing, brother? He watching you. See how you took what he dropped on you last night. Or what she dropped on you last night. because they got she droppers as well as he droppers. If you're not wise, first thing you should do is say, well, I was well till I talked to this dude. I was feeling fine. Now I got a headache, man. All of a sudden your spirit is down. See, you come to the mosque because you know it's where you should be. But, all right, brothers, here's the paper. You ain't got the strength to pick up a paper. Where you gladly gave in charity with a smile, you don't get nothing this week. You don't get nothing next week. And maybe your attendance gets slack. And you begin to think this is a game. Somebody's tricking you. Because you've been tricked all your life. And you think now this is another one. Brother and sister, let me straighten you out real quick, you know. This is an awful game to play. You know, I could do so many things with my life. Believe me, I'm a very talented brother. I don't need this to make a living for my family. I didn't need this to make a living for my family before I met this. I want to make it very clear to you. You ain't got nothing that I want to rob you of. They say all that a man has, he'll give for his life. My life is on the line, brother. When you see the CIA, the FBI after me, when you see the Bush don't like me, the Jews don't like me, these are powerful enemies. Then if I wanted to be loved, I could play the game like Jesse. If I wanted to be loved, what I mean is, when I say play the game, I could stop talking about what concerns black people and talk about our America, our Constitution, our flag, but you know it ain't ours. And if you don't know it, I know it. I can't play that game. Even if it meant that I die, I'd rather be dead than to play that game. No, I can't say my country 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty. You talk that crap, but I can't do that and be true to who and what I am. No, this ain't no sweet land of liberty. It's a cursed land of slavery and debauchery and evil. And I gotta stand up and say it like it is. So don't think that the little car that the brothers bought me, limousine or some little car I drive or nice clothes I wear, that's payment for my work. You can't pay me for what I do. I'm not promised no money for what I do. I'm promised a reward from God for what I do. So, the fact that I ride in a nice car or wear nice clothes don't make me good. And the fact that you may not have those things doesn't make you less than I am. Because this is not the measure of a man. It's here and it's here. That's where the real man is. So the dragon stands before the woman to kill the man-child. Nothing in the nation will be successful without the men. It's wonderful to have sisters that help, but this is not church. In the church, the women run that house. Because the men are non-productive. It's the women who work in the church. Is that right?
Yes, sir. That's right.
You should work wherever you are. But since God made us with two legs, don't you think a man ought to work for his woman?
Yes, sir.
Come on.
Yes, sir.
Then if this is a true house of God, and man was made to have dominion and power, then brothers, it's you that have to carry the nation on your shoulder. That's why the brothers in the FOI have the sun, moon, and star on their shoulders. The sisters don't have that. Because the book said the government would be upon his shoulder. And he would be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Prince of Peace, the Everlasting Father. Well, that's what you came here for, brothers, to help work to build a nation for your woman and your children to enjoy. That means if the men are weak, the nation is weak. If the men are strong, the nation is strong. If the men are strong and the women are strong and supportive, the nation is super strong. And that's why the dragon stands before Mosque Maryam. Since this is the headquarters mosque of the nation, they got the most skilled hypocrites in this house. Because if they can stop us at the center, then they can stop us in New York, in LA, in Atlanta, and all the cities across the country. So their skilled devils will be here working. They work on the leadership. They start from the top down and from the bottom up. They're termites. They love to sow the seed of dissension between the leadership, because usually they're always in all organizations, particularly where there are black people, there's always some kind of power struggle. Somebody not happy with their post want to be something else. And the people ain't crazy, they see it. So some will slip up next to you. I think that you ought to be the minister. You're so intelligent, so smart. I just love the way you teach. I mean, the spirit is just all over. You should be the minister. And you act like you didn't hear it. After a while, that stuff starts feeding you. I'm going to close. The object of a hypocrite is to kill the progress, the onward motion, the forward motion of an individual and a people. Now, that Muhammad University of Islam, small, insignificant, but its record is better than the record of any school in the nation, white or black. Now, that's significant. You graduate 10 high school students, 50% of your class, your graduating class, are honor students, and 4 of 10, not 2, but 4, are in who's who of American high school students. 4 out of 10. You ain't got that in no school in America but at Muhammad University of Islam. Now, regardless to what fault we find with our own school, the product is the witness.
Yes, sir.
Everything can be improved. But if we take what we have and work with it and make it better and better and better, then maybe all 10 or 15 will graduate and be in who's who. A hypocrite wants to destroy that school. So they'll speak against the school. So you'll take your child out of the school. There's always going to be problems. But this is yours. So you don't want to abandon what is yours. You want to fix what is yours. You live in a house, that's your house. If there's a crack in the ceiling, you don't go try to buy another house. You fix the crack in the ceiling. That's your house. And the dragon stood before the woman to devour her child as soon as it was born. My appeal to you, my dear believers, is to remain steadfast and strong in the faith. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And don't let the enemy drag you down from the mount of truth after you have mounted up. Don't let the enemy drag you out of the light of God back into the darkness from which we came. Yes, sir. Don't let the enemy do that. And in order for you not to let the enemy do that, you've got to be on guard 23 hours, 56 minutes, 46 seconds, every day, every day, every week, every month, every year. You can't fall asleep on your post. You got to walk your post in a perfect manner. Enemy do that. You've got to be on guard 23 hours, 56 minutes, 46 seconds, every day, every day, every week, every month, every year. You can't fall asleep on your post. You got to walk your post in a perfect manner, keeping always on the alert, observing everything within sight or hearing. You have to be an observant person.
Yes, sir.
You got to listen to people when they talk. And when they don't talk right, check them. Hey, brother, that's the wrong word. You speak like that again, and I'll report you.
Yes,
what do you mean? We can't have no snitch. That's like seeing a cockroach in your house. And you don't want to put Raid on the cockroach. After a while, the cockroach will multiply and multiply and multiply because you saw one and you slept on the one. Now there's five. Now there's 10. Now there's a colony of them, and they're driving you out of your house. And that's what a hypocrite is. He's a human cockroach crawling out of the dark. You don't come out when the light is on, you run. But when the dark comes, the cockroach will move out looking for some filth. Cockroach you can't find in a clean place. Human cockroaches. You see, I can't report that, brother. He said, report all slackness and wrongdoing. Why? You want to keep your nation strong. Me and you as buddies. Me and you. Me and you. We hanging together. Me and you. We Muslims and we buddies. Me and you. You and me. We down. Come on over to my house. You come over. I'm feeling you out. See what you'll go for. You know, when I was out there in the world, man, I used to smoke a lot of reefer. What about you?
Oh,
I used to smoke a lot myself. I put it down, man. I put it down. But I'm telling you, sometimes I get weak. You know what I mean? I think about it.
Well, you know, brother, I tell you, I'm trying to clean up, you know what I mean? But just before I came into mosque, I bought a pound. And I really didn't want to throw it away. Because, you know, the messenger teaches us to be practical.
Yes, sir.
And look, brother, since I got this pound and I'm not going to throw it away, I made up my mind, understand, that after this is done, I ain't never going to return to this no more. So why don't we do up a joint together? You and me. Me and you. My man. As-salamu alaykum. Before you know it, you and him got a joint you smoking. And after you smoke the joint, you feel real guilty, sister. This is how they work. You trying to be right. He says, sister, I'm coming in the nation. You know what I mean? Me and you. Me and you. And you know, it's a clean life in the nation. There's no fornication, there's no adultery, nothing like that. Nothing like that. But sis, you know, I mean, they give you time to get it together. And while we getting it together, why don't we just get together and help get it together? Here go another one. Into fornication in a long dress. Reefer smoker with his bow tie on. Homosexual hiding in the ranks. That's real, man.
Yes, sir.
But it's me and you. See, people don't do evil alone. They got to do it with somebody. Ain't that something? You can't be a hypocrite by yourself. You got to recruit. If you use drugs, you're trying to find somebody to use it with you. If you're a homosexual or lesbian, you got to find somebody that will go that way with you. Come on. It's charity. You gotta share. You share evil, you share good. Now you're on the road to hypocrisy. All dressed up with your bow tie on, your fine suit, your long dress. But you've been smoking that reefer last night. You've been partying. Had a little affair. I'm in a mosque tonight. Praise it due to Allah. The minister's teaching a hard subject like I'm doing tonight. And guilt come over you and say, I'm going to tell it. I got to tell something. It's eating me up on the inside. I got to tell somebody. Then the one that you're going to tell on spies you in the audience and looks at you with that cold look. Don't you report me. Oh, I'll tell on you too. We'll all get time together. So one is covering the other's backside. You understand?
Yes, sir.
And before you know it, the house starts beginning to stink. Corruption. And then the power of the house begins to diminish. And the light in the house begins to go dim. And darkness begins to come over the house. And pretty soon the hearts wax cold. And before you know it, we can't get anything going anymore because we have become hypocrites. We broke our oath and we promised Allah, look, Allah, if you would just enrich me out of your grace, I'm going to be righteous. I'm going to clean it up. I'm going to do it. And Allah said, okay, I'll try you. And he enriches you. Then you get niggardly. And then he requites you with hypocrisy in your hearts till the day you meet him, because we broke our promise with Allah and because we lied. And if we become a house like that, the dragon has already won. He has dragged us down from the Mount of Truth, dragged us out of light into darkness, dragged us from strength into weakness. We are no longer what we thought we were. There's no condition that can't be reversed. So I don't want to leave you with the thought in mind that a condition like that can't be reversed. To the brother who may have that pound, and you down to a half a pound and got another month or so to smoke reefer and to give somebody else reefer, I'm asking you tonight to go home and throw it all away. And stop lying to yourself. You ain't going nowhere with no joint. Clean it up. Don't wait till tomorrow. You shacking up with one of the sisters. We married. And you ain't got no papers, nothing. Just shacking. Let's cut it out. Look what it says here. And certainly they spoke the word of disbelief and disbelieve after their Islam. And you know something? When you say you submit and then going to justify a reefer, you're speaking the word of disbelief. Justify crookedness, con games, lesbianism, homosexuality, adultery, fornication, anything that you justify. After you know what is right, you're speaking the word of disbelief after your Islam. You're on the road to hypocrisy. And that's a dangerous road. I would advise everybody, get off that road. Get off that road. There is no power greater than a mind that has peace and contentment because it's true to itself. That is the ultimate joy, to know that when you lay down tonight, I lay down in peace because I have harmed no one, I have not broken the divine law, and if I have strayed a little, I've repented and tried to correct my course and get it back on track. See, the God don't want to hurt you. So he's telling you, look, if you would just repent, it would be good for you. You know what that means? If you would come to the realization that what you're doing is wrong and feel sorry enough about it that you make up your mind you're not going to do it again, and then develop the strength to say, I'm not going to do it again, throw the reefer out, throw the cocaine out. Cut out your unlawful action. Now, it's easier said than done, isn't it? You need help, man. All of us need help. You know, there's a song we used to sing in the church. Just a closer walk with thee. Huh? And say, I am weak, but thou art strong. Keep me, Jesus, from all wrong. I'll be satisfied as long as I walk close to thee. You want to walk with God. You want to walk with the messenger of God. That's the way you get your strength. You don't want to feel accursed. And when you're, you know, we say, A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. I seek refuge in Allah against the accursed devil, one who is removed
from the face of God is one who is accursed. And you can't walk with God and be sinning against God. So every time we sin against God, it's like we're taking steps backward. God walking and we can't walk with him because our sin won't allow us to walk with God. So the more you keep falling back behind God, the weaker you get and the weaker you get and the weaker you get. So you got to close the gap between you and God. And the only way you can close it, only way we can close it, is we got to repent. You don't have to talk to me. You don't have to talk to Brother Ishmael. You have to go tell people, I'm the one he was talking about. I got that pound of reefer. How did he know? I don't know. I didn't tell nobody. If I said something that got into your personal life, nobody told me nothing about you. I'm just preaching. And God uses me as an instrument. So if in any way I have illuminated some weakness in you or myself, then give God the credit. Don't come to me, Minister, I'm the one you were talking about. Leave me alone. I got enough problems to deal with. Please don't bring that to me. Look here. If you just want to confess, tell you what you do. You go home tonight in the quiet of your room. You ain't got to tell nobody. Just talk to God. Say, look, God, you know, I've been weak. You know I've been weak because I can't fool you. But I want to come up out of it. And I need strength to do it. I'm sorry for what I've done, and if you give me a chance, I won't go back to that. I really want to be strong. I really want to be a good Muslim. I don't want to be a dragon. I don't want to drag nobody out of light into darkness. I don't want to be a hypocrite. I want to be a true believer, because I know those are the ones that you have favor with and that have favor with you. And if you talk to the God like that, I mean, he is off returning to mercy, the merciful. He ain't going to say, get the hell out my face. He's going to say, come unto me, all ye that are heavy laden with sin. I'm going to give you rest. Just come to me, not Farrakhan. Come to the God who came in the person of Master Farad Muhammad. Don't go to no spook or no spirit. Talk to the real God who came to show mercy to you and me. Huh? Look at this now. All praise is due to Allah. Y'all all right? No, my time is up. My time is up. Go home and talk to the God. And when you talk to him, if you're sincere, the tears will fall out of your eyes. Because really, you're good people. You are really good people. You're not bad. You just get caught up into things that aren't good. But you're not bad. But you need strength to overcome weakness, don't we? So you start with prayer, and you got to make your prayer sincere, man. Can't be talking in your mind going to the Olympics. Man, I wonder who won the 8-8. And then after that, you get up. You feel clean. But now here's what you got to do to get strong. We have to learn that food is the key to being able to control passions. Food. There are some foods that you eat, they stir your passions. Make you a hot tamale. Some other kind of inflamed species. And there are other foods you can eat to cool you down. This is a world that's constantly titillating the sexual impulse in the human being. You need to eat food. We need to eat foods that water that down, cool it, particularly those who are single
And even a married brother, you got to have some measure of control. You heard about his husbands raping their wives, right? Can I get some water? Oh, here it is. I got to cool this one down. I can't get into this. A man should never rape his wife. I mean, there are times when a woman just is tired. I say something wrong? There are times when a sister just has had a hard day and she really does not wish to be bothered. Ain't no sense in it.
Look here, girl.
Excuse me. It's good to be able to control yourself. That when your mate isn't up to it, you throw the thought out your mind. There'll be a better a day or night coming soon. Previews of coming attractions. But a man shouldn't rape a woman. And a man should never be such a dog. He around here begging a woman.
Baby, please.
Brother, you should be ashamed of yourself. Excuse me. I think I should go. My time is up. You must cut back on red meat if you want to control passions. Get away from red meat. Steak, lamb. Well, you know we don't take pork, so that's out of the question. But all red meat, back up. If you deal more with vegetables and fruits, you'll find,
man, I can't build no muscles. You know what I mean? I got to have me a steak. You know what I mean? I'm pressing weights and stuff. You know, I got to eat me a steak.
Well, let me tell you, when you go out in the field one day, you check out a horse. You ain't got no muscle to equal the muscles of a horse, do you? Any muscle.
Wait. Order in the court. Order. Can we have order in the court, please?
But if you study the horse, this majestic animal, when that animal is moving, running a race, look at the beauty of the muscles in a horse. And they eat grass, grains. You can't build more muscle from eating the meat of the horse that got his muscle from eating the grain. Go to the same grain and the same grass or leafy vegetable that the horse ate. You can build muscle with that. That's how you built yours in the beginning. Hello. Now, the last thing I want to say is we must learn to fast. The Quran says fasting is prescribed for you as it was prescribed for those before you. And you know what, sisters and brothers? If we would just stop eating just for 3 days, drink water, good clean water, but then stop eating food. Try it for a day. Say, I'm not going to eat nothing today. I'm going to drink water. I mean, your stomach's gonna be calling now. It'll be talking to you. Just talk back.
I ain't putting no food in you today. You can scream all you want to. I'm the boss here.
And don't put no food in. You think I'm lying? That's what the messenger told me. Talk to your stomach. And when you talk to it, it'll start getting quiet. Because you the boss. After one day, you'll say, man, I did that for one whole day. Then try two. Then one day, try three. And let me tell you something, brother. When you can stop eating, then you can gain control of sexual appetite. All sex is a hunger. Just like food. It's a natural hunger. So if you can suppress the desire for food, then you can suppress and control the desire for sex. And once you got that stuff under control, then you're just a little bit closer in your walk with God. And you and I can be stronger and stronger and get more and more away from speaking the word of disbelief after our submission to the will of God. May Allah bless us as a community to strive to be Muslims, to strive to be right. And those who have fallen and have been weak, go home tonight and repent of it and make up your mind that you'll never return to that kind of behavior again. And ask Allah to help you, and then help yourself by changing your diet and then learning how to fast. May Allah bless you all, and thank you so much for coming out. And don't forget, on Friday night is study group. You know, you've been on that study guide 18, I guess, for the last year and a half. I wrote study guide 19 and 20, but I just haven't sent them over to you. And I wondered why myself, but I guess it's because there's something in study guide 18 that I want you to study, I want you to master, so that the nation will never, ever fall again. May Allah bless you, Muslims. Thank you for a wonderful evening as I greet you in peace. Assalamu alaikum.
Let's give him a warm round of applause, the Honorable Louis Farrakhan. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. All praises due to Allah. You may be seated. Dear brothers and sisters,